very interested in the things that these brilliant photographers have to say. The panel is titled Long-Term In-Depth Documentary Storytelling. So, photography is hard work. You know, we just see the glitz and glamour from outside, but it takes a long, long time to produce something good. So I think this panel will uncover or rediscover some of that aspect. And the panelists here are Janatul Mawa, Tasneem Al-Sultan, Kishore Sharma, and is moderated by Hanamari Shakya. Hanamari is a very, very old friend, and I don't know if you know this. I don't know. Maybe. I don't know if you know this, but I started my photography from the workshop that you organized here. So that was my first workshop in photography. Thank you so much. Yeah, Hanamari is a professional working with documentary photography and also film. She herself is also a photographer who focuses on long-term documentary storytelling, and she teaches workshops on long-term documentary storytelling as well. She is the founder editor of Raw View magazine based in Finland. It's a photography magazine, and she does a lot of other things. Like, as photographers, we don't like to do strategic work and budget making and all that. She does that. And she also lectures, she's a mentor, she teaches workshops, like I said, and she's also a curator and collaborates with different institutions. So, on to the panel. Thank you so much. And Hanamari will introduce the panel.
You have to bear actually four different accents. So none of us are English native speakers, so I hope that you understand what we are talking about, and I hope that we understand each other. So I hope that we have a great time and a great discussion. And if you have any questions, please ask, but let's start with the images of...
Thank you.
Janato's work. So we're going to discuss how and why do we tell stories, and this is the nut we are going to crack today. So I'm sure this is a bit confusing, but this is actually the kind of key to the storytelling. We need to find the right question, only then we can find the answer. Often the answer is the question. This question reveals who you are as a photographer and a human being. So this is the first question to you. Why do you photograph?
Hello everyone, my name is Kishore Sarma. So the first work that you saw, that is mine. Why do I photograph? I mean, to be honest, first I do it for the view. I do it professionally. I live through photography basically. So I do assignments and I teach photography and all that sort of works. Besides that, I find some time to do the work that that somehow. The subject matter that intrigues me, the story that hasn't been told earlier. Or, if I find that kind of issue or subject matter, then I photograph. So basically, these are two sides of my photography.
And what do you say, Dustin?
Do you want to switch places now? So, I initially started as a hobby to be a photographer, but I see photography as a storytelling, and it's a way of raising awareness and sharing my experience with others and provoking, you know, thoughts and answers, especially in a culture that's very conservative, at least to outsiders. So that's why I'm a photographer, and especially in Saudi. Is that a good answer?
I never wanted to be a... I never wanted to be a photographer, rather filmmaker or something more. As an activist, later I found if I'm going to be a dancer, I may convey the same message what I wanted to convey. So photography is a strong medium to convey my message, because I strongly believe I have some particular role for society. So I know photography cannot change everything overnight, but it's my question.
So how do you find the subject matter?
In my case, it's usually, regarding my personal projects, because I do like a lot of assignments. For my personal projects, I try to, unless the subject matter of the issue doesn't intrigue me, and I don't need to take it. It has to somehow intrigue my curiosity, or it has to make me curious to go for that subject matter, those kind of issues. Then I start my project.
But how did you find the route, the theme?
It has a long story, actually. So the nomadic study that I did, earlier in Nepal, there used to have other nomadic group as well, like the three or four other nomadic group, and they all slowly they settled down, as in like they got assimilated with the modern, so-called modern society. But these groups were still trying to carry this lifestyle that later I found like they could be the one of the people who colonized this land for the first time long ago. So I felt like, and then there were a lot of the time there were news in the media, like when they used to come to Kathmandu to meet the president or prime minister or things like that. But we hardly used to see how they live, or like what is the place that they live in. So that made me really curious, and I took up I started this story actually during a workshop. I went there, and then that's how it got started. But I'm still, whenever I have some time, I go there and I try to meet them and then, yeah, take a picture, do my story.
That's me, how about you?
So my master's was in social anthropology and social linguistics, and my thesis was about Saudi women and how they perceive themselves to outsiders and how they live abroad and how they want people to see them. So photography is so much easier to, instead of writing, I'm better at photography than writing, and it was easier for me to share it with a larger audience. So when it came to this project or any other, it's my location, I am from Saudi, I wanted to photograph in the same answers, but in a different medium. With this project in particular, I feel like I have a medium of being someone who's a Westerner, born and raised in the US, but also a Saudi. So I'm both a Westerner and an Arab, and at the same time, I'm neither one of them, because by Westerners, I'm always Arab, and by Arabs, I'm always a Westerner. So I try to use photography to kind of tell each other's story, each side, and kind of cover them and hopefully make them friends.
But being in between is sort of a very good position too.
Yeah.
And genital.
I never pushed myself to choose such making because nothing is personal. I'm seeing everything is political. So as a privileged person, when I'm a photographer, I wanted to do something what the things people are not talking so much. So that way I select my subject. Usually I do like this, that I mean, which will use for near future to do something. And for that, I mean, we shouldn't go so far. And for in this case, I can see, I mean, at home also, discrimination is the way we are looking at other human.
Yes, we talk more about this. So, make it personal or not. So both of you, Jannatul and Tasneen, you have been working in a very personal level. So let's talk about how do we kind of share our private moments and our personal life.
I just answered your previous question that nothing is personal for me actually. Yeah, I have some personal moments I can make it and keep it in my, as a diary, keep it in my laptop, or if I want I can show for, but I think as it a strong medium, what I feel personally even, I think somehow I should connect it to the others who are, that we can see ourselves in a mirror, actually what we are doing for them. I mean, so it's not a personal thing, everything is political for me in some way.
But it's kind of intertwined, because you told me yesterday that your story actually, the first kind of a image which has not been taken is actually you and your maid.
Yeah, so. Of course, that is why I said, I mean, nothing is personal for me. I mean, I started this work because I felt so much. I mean, I brought up with a housemaid, I mean, who is our relative also. So I'm here for them because someone is looking after my home. That is why I'm here. So the discrimination is not actually, I mean, people how look at personality. This is came from how society looking at rich people or poor people. So yeah, the feelings is personal, but I wanted to communicate in a larger viewer. I treated it as a very serious issue.
Yeah, but I feel that many times personal projects actually have much more layers, and one of the layers can be a political or social perspective. So what do you think, Tasneen? You have really opened your doors to your home.
Yeah, that was not the first intention at all. I wanted to be a storyteller. I was Shahrazad from 1001 Arabian Nights, and I was going to tell everyone else's story. Initially, I faced a lot of difficulty because no one wanted to have any sort of stigma. As a Saudi woman, why are you sharing our pity stories with the rest of the world? No one likes that, especially not me. And I wanted to be like this. I'm a wedding photographer, and I'm opening the doors in the fantasy world, and I'm showing you the reality after. And then no one wanted to show me those stories. So I started, first of all, with my grandmother. An arranged marriage, and then my daughter, because she's never been in love and she's a young girl. Basically, I was forced to use my family. So I started photographing them more and more. And then slowly, a friend of a friend loosened up and she allowed me because she's a little bit better. She has a positive twist where she remarried after her divorce. So something kind of pulled another story and relationships and everything. But really, everyone opened up when I actually shared my own story, which was, I'm divorced, so I'm one of you. We can all be in a group therapy project together. And the more I started opening up and sharing pictures of my diary, which I really resisted until I finished the project, a 6-month project at the time, with the grant, my mentor kept telling me, I need to see you. And I'm like, I don't take bio pictures or self-portraits. I think it's silly. I really don't like it. So up until the end, when I was forced, I finally added my 16-year-old, like when I was 16, my last picture, a photo of my handwriting, which has misspellings and it has like lipstick and drawings and everything. And but I understand, when I shared my vulnerability with everyone else, everyone shared them back. And now, finally, I'm having sad women coming to share that personal project. They want to be included.
But you thought also yesterday that it has brought a lot of difficulties in your life because you are seen in a kind of a stigmatized way. So can you talk about that a bit?
So the project has been published in different, you know, mainstream and printed here, but mostly it was published in Time Magazine a few weeks ago. And as soon as it was, because it was in English, no one cared. But then a Saudi publication stole that story and mistranslated it to be a revengeful Saudi divorcee who's also very famous for shooting weddings, is, you know, complaining about her ex-husband, which was nothing. Like, no. And then I received phone calls and I received, you know, from family members, how dare you, why would you do that, why are you, you know, why are you sharing bad stories about him? They were my family, but they were complaining about him. Like why I exposed him. So they didn't read the actual English version, and it really upset me because I also get a lot of angry text messages from people on Instagram, why are you sharing my bad stories with everyone? My reply, I sat my parents down and I just said, I am. It's a fact. My daughters are, you know, with a single parent. Again, it's a fact. Instead of our culture and society kind of saying, oh, do you want help? Do you need anything? It was more of how dare you, and it was shaming. So that's the society that I've come from. I don't know if it's personal or the same with everyone else, but it was therapeutic because then it made my parents kind of go quiet. They didn't know what to say.
Interesting. So in a way, opening your doors, it also closed many doors for you. Yeah.
You have seen a lot of, as an editor, you have seen a lot of work. So how do you define the personal work, and like does it have to be picture about you and your family?
No.
Or like how do you see the personal?
No,
process?
Personal doesn't mean that it has to be about you or your intimate family. Personal can actually, I was going to ask you a question, because I have a theory. I've been running workshops for quite almost 10 years. And professional photographers come there in the workshop with always, and they apply with an ID. And it's a process. And after a while, it takes usually a month, they realize that I'm actually telling my own story. And this is very difficult to comprehend, but it means that every question we have as our, I mean, as a private person, it's actually something that is fascinating us. And that's why I wanted to ask you, because there has to be a connection. Or maybe, because we are not talking about news photography, so photojournalism is not sort of on focus here, because that's a totally different case. But most long-term projects, they demand the question. So I'm asking you, what was your question?
It is somehow related to the work that I've been doing, you know, like, maybe a lot of people ask me, like, you are, I mean, though I was born in Fiji and I was grown up and I was raised in Kathmandu, you know, like, I'm one of these urban youth, or I mean, whatever you can say. So why do you want to take picture of the tribe or the nomad people who live, like, far in the jungle? I mean, so, I think, like, I found, I mean, when I started, I didn't have that thing in my mind, but like as I get along, I find this kind of connection. They are nomads, their living style is nomadic, but somehow I feel my mental state is also nomadic. Or I somehow connect with them when I go there. So because they love isolation, they don't want to like go there with all these things out there. That was really something that I could connect to, and I think that could also be a personal thing.
Yes, that's exactly. I mean, it can be an impulse to start working on a project, but then you realize that it's actually something that can be very hidden in our own personalities. And I've seen that really, I mean, experienced photographers much older than me come with a very plain idea, and then during years of working, because I run these workshops that can last 4 years, so they actually, it's amazing to see. Of course, it's a kind of a process, like almost going to a therapy, and I feel most of the times I feel like a therapist and a mother, but that's fine. It's really fine, and I think it's a beautiful trip that we make. And always, always, it doesn't matter in which culture you come from, but there is always some kind of breaking point. And a lot of the times, always in the meetings that we meet, somebody cries, and I usually cry with them. So.
I think I was studying in Dennis's club journalism in 2014. In the second semester, they forced us to do a personal project, you know, in 1 month. And my mentor used to show a lot of the crying pictures, you know, because all of the participants were doing the personal project. At some point, they used to get break, and then they used to send out this picture of them crying, you know.
Yeah, that's the trip. Okay, so let's talk about how do you find the right perspective. So now you have your story. So tell about the process, or how do you find the right angle? Can you start?
Regarding which aspect?
Sorry?
Regarding which aspect, I mean, you are asking?
Just talk about your own project. Like, how do you, you have a very formal way of photographing.
Okay.
You have 6x6, and how do you sort of?
Few days ago, I also shared these things. There is a phrase, called arts for art's sake. So it sounds good, but when I do any project, even in the class when I teach my student, I always open for style, language, or anything. And when they ask me, as a beginner, should we make our own signature or something? So every photographer has their own signature, but my signature is not style or aesthetic or something. It's more focused on content base. So I wanted to say something very directly. And when I was shoot that project, it always came to my mind that I shouldn't do something more, which is lost through the visual gimmick or something. So it's very compact and very calculative. That way, in a minimalistic way, I made that project.
But you kind of, in order to make this kind of minimalistic decisions, you kind of, did you try something else? How did you find that path? Mm-hmm. Or did you, your first image is like this, a square image, and really?
Because I don't have medium format camera, but I wanted to give more emphasis to my subject and object as well. So I wanted to focus what I really wanted to show, not more than that, than 35 or something. So I cropped that things. That way I decided to make it more focused.
Yeah, because the interesting thing is that you're almost putting the people in a box. That's the, you know, when you start to kind of look at the formats.
Yeah.
So your format is almost like investigating these two persons and their relations to each other.
From now, I'm in a position to, at least I want to talk here, but when I started this work, tell you very frankly that I was not that much intelligent that the very first day I decided all these things. Slowly, as it is a long-term process, when I put all these photographs in the table, I added more what is missing there. That way I changed so many things. First I use one flash, then I use two flashes. Then first I only went for middle class, then I tried to crop it rich, and there are so many tribal groups, we are living together, that society also. Then I added male, even male house owner and male these things. But as I mean, in our country context, household chores doing for doing women. So that way I did lots of experiment, as it is my own project. It's not asset for anyone. So slowly, slowly, even through this work, I learned so many things.
And what about you, Dustin?
So I usually shoot weddings, so I use different lens, but always with a digital camera. My favorite lens is a 35mm, just because I feel like it's the right kind of natural eyesight that I would see, or perspective. And then most of the story's begun because it started with my grandmother and my daughter. It was a day of, you know, very documentary, just normal, natural, no poses. And then my mentor at the time, Tanya Habjuga, kept saying, we want to see a little bit more. So she started sharing projects and work of other photographers, and I understood that I needed to do something of a collaborative portrait. So I started sitting with each of the women and describing, what do you want? How do you perceive yourself in perception to love, marriage, divorce, or happiness, or freedom? And it was always at the end. So I would stay with them for a few days, get the normal, you know, life that they led, and then in the end, each one would kind of think about it. So I don't know if we can look at some of the images. But with each woman, so I shot in the end 10 stories, but with each, and it's in others. With each individual, they had a different story. So Khadir is a wedding planner. She's never been married or in love, but if anyone asks her, she says, I'm married to my work. She has 70 men working for her. And she, when, like on a wedding day, she is, you know, very fierce. So we just started, I photographed her doing things in her PJs in the morning, having breakfast, and I stay over with them. Then this is her tent, so she was just, I don't know why she received a call and she was on the chair in her PJs. So I photographed her on my phone because she looked silly, and she just looked at me. So I said, okay, what's the portrait? What do you want to do? And she's like, I want to wear a big poofy fairy tale dress, okay? The chairs were already there, but we moved them to the middle of the tent. And then she was playing with the phone, she started climbing, doing different poses, and then she just took her strand of hair and put it here. Like, it wasn't pose, it was the last photo of the whole idea. But as soon as she did it, I knew it was the one, because she is in charge. Like, in our culture, a woman who is single and is strong, then they say she replaces 100 men. You know, she's parallel to 100 men. But it's not a good thing. Like, our society says it in a bad way. So with her, she's like, I don't care. I have all these chairs which are representing men, and I'm the stronger one here. I'm in power. So I love this one. I'll just show you one more. With May, she's a dentist. She fell in love with her college sweetheart. They got married 6 years after 2 children. Her husband was on a motorcycle accident and he died the day before he signed the lease of buying the house. So she had to pay the lease, because I don't know about different countries, but in Saudi Arabia, if you die, if a husband dies, passes away in an accident of some sort, then she wouldn't have had the burden to pay for the house. So her stepbrother, who she hasn't met, is her legal guardian for now. Until then, until her son turns 16, he will then be her legal guardian. So I photographed her being a very, you know, powerful woman, a dentist. She has so many obstacles in her daily life because she can't drive, as some women can't drive. When it came to the collaborative portrait, and I asked her, how do you see yourself with regards to love and marriage, she sat her daughter and son down, and she asked them, what do you want to do? The daughter, it was Halloween, she had Halloween makeup on, so she was playing. But the son said, I want to wear my father's thobe and his helmet that he passed away in. And she said, then I want to wear my wedding dress that I haven't worn in 16, 15 years. And she just sat there. So we took different portraits with the picture of the father in the middle holding hands. But this one just resonated, and it was so emotional because she looks beautiful, and the son looks, he is a replica of his father. And it was just so quiet and calm for them. It was a very serene moment. So when I photographed this and I showed later on all these women, they were very powerful to them. For them to see that project, they felt like we are together. We're not alone. We didn't know that so many of us existed. So it, my photography changed. So I still photograph documentary, but I have to have a collaborative portrait at the end of each individual.
So you have really chosen your angle.
Yeah.
That reflects in all this, so this is one chapter of that story.
Yeah. So each woman would have her regular daily life images, just documentary, and then a powerful, or I hope to be a powerful portrait of each one.
And how about you, Kishore?
Yeah, I think in my case as well, as you have seen, my work is, I mean, in terms of style and aesthetics, it's basically, it fits into that traditional documentary storytelling aesthetics, or like a reportage aesthetic. Because since I was from the very beginning, I was shooting with a 35mm, and to be honest, like the people whom I learn from or the people whom I look after, they're all like these classical black and white documentary photographers, and somehow that influenced my aesthetic or the perspective as well. But lately, I mean, for the other story as well, I have been trying to like break out of this box as well. But I mean, it's quite. But I found like this. I mean, to be honest, this fits my, I think, way of working, this style and this perspective. So.
So let's talk about medium. We're a little bit past.
You yourself, Anna.
Yes.
I'm asking to you, I mean, how do you find your anger as a storyteller?
Oh, it can be a challenge. I mean, my last personal project I did for 7 years, and honestly, it was very difficult, and I did some of the shootings 3 times. So it was a question of actually angle and the medium. So next we're talking about the medium, because I think that's a very, this is a controversial topic. Some of the people say that, oh, it doesn't matter if you have a Mamiya 6x7 camera or you have some kind of cheap plastic pocket camera. But I really claim that there is a big difference, and we talk about the differences now. So how do you think Janatula affects that you told that you cropped, so you are obviously using digital, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So how did you choose it? How? Or did you make a choice?
I used to say one thing. I mean, if someone has concept and someone has intelligence, he or she can do with an entrepreneur. I mean, she or he can do. I mean, do something with an entrepreneur. So for me, conceptual thing is more important. Of course, we are doing photography, and it's itself, camera itself, technical things. I sometimes wanted to be very slow, so. I wanted to work through large format also. My upcoming project, I'm still not sure. I mean, I'm going to make it through large format or 35, because I really wanted to blow up it. So regarding the size and the process, I wanted to make something through large format, but I don't have any large format camera. So it's related to me, I mean, but I have access sometimes. That way I decided. So, I mean, say for example, as I don't have large format camera, so few days ago I brought a new camera with a 50 resolution. So I went to go for a crop or something. So it's related to work, content, what kind of things I am going to do.
Yeah, sometimes you can play a bit frown. Like, if you don't have a film camera, you can pretend that you have one, which means that you actually slow down and you can use tripod. And there are actually many ways, because when you kind of have the normal photojournalistic way of working, then you might take during, I would work on an analog camera 6x7, I would take one image, and in the digital I would take 60 images, for example. So, because I really believe that there is a huge difference. Also, how the people who you photograph, how they respond.
Yeah, and I can share you one really simple things. When I started photography, I always do photography. I never look back. Even I never click, just for fun even. So once I went for trekking, and I brought a very simple camera. It's called Index camera, equivalent to, what do you call it? What is called, Jishan? I must take Polaroid. So my friend who was with me, those who are with me, they have large format, they have medium format, they have so many things, but I never use this kind of camera. So I was very fascinated with that camera. I hold this one. I never take a camera like that one. So once one rainbow shone up between two mountain. So I didn't look at my Canon. I turn on my that camera, and my friend they were screaming, "Hey, why you are opening you this camera? And it don't have multiple exposure or something, blah blah blah. You can take our this camera." That day I feel sometimes we have to be slow, really need to be slow, and gone through the this kind of process. And I click and. When it's calm, when it's exposed, I never feel like photography. I would love to click photography like this. So yeah, we have to explore all kind of this, but it's again related to content and what you needed. This time is slow, or you need to like photojournalistic work or reporters. Just related to this.
Yeah, I think in a way, long-term projects are connected to slow.
Yes.
Work or slow journalism, depending of what position you take. So that's the name.
I've been using the same camera because that's the only one I know how to use. I changed lens, but I don't know how to use any non-digital, non-Canon.
Non-Canon.
Okay.
And you,
Kisha?
I think it makes a difference which camera, I'm not saying like it makes a difference in the output or the story, but it makes a difference in the process, I guess. Lately, I've been trying to shoot analog, but it's medium format, and it's almost like really almost a religious, this this process. And then because like it obviously like Mawa said, it slows you down. Like you said, since I was so tired of shooting in the same like this 35mm. This reported style shooting, and then I thought maybe I should try something different, and then I got that thing, and I think it makes a certain, first it changes, it makes a difference in your mind, and then in the process, I guess. Because tonight we are also in the Nepali slide, so we are showing one work of the Nepali photographer, Sumendra Lal. He lives in Canada, and but he comes back to Nepal to work in Nepal. He has done this project on the large format camera, and once I saw him working on it, it was like to take one picture, it takes like half an hour, So it's all about process, and it suddenly you can see in the picture, like somehow it reflects in his picture, like the process. So I think to do some kind of work, obviously, because the 35mm was designed to work in this way, in the fast pace and then the street style and all the journalistic style. So. Obviously, the medium makes a difference.
It's interesting because I made this long-term project, as I said, that with three cameras. I started with digital and I went to 6x6 Hasselblad, and then I actually ended up using 6x7 Mamiya. And the interesting thing is how people respond to your camera, because when you have a digital camera, you actually look directly through the camera, so like this, you know. And when you work with Hasselblad or Mamiya, and I use this, I don't know the English name, but I look down, so I'm like this when I photograph. And it takes a long time, and people get more relaxed, and it's kind of bluffing too. So because it's obviously, everybody understands that I'm looking at them, but it doesn't feel like it. And in a way, my theory is that I'm kind of more humble when I put my head down. And I love photographing that way, because people kind of, they are not so tense, and they forget me in a way. But this is also part of the working process.
And I think that's why we always look at junior market camera approaches, huh? I mean, when you look at the photographs, that those photographs, and it's something like timeless. How relaxed, subject with photographers. I mean, as it is, take long time, so there are so much intimacy between the subject and camera and the photographers.
Yes. And then there are actually ways of distract the person who we are photographing. So when I teach other people to make portraits, I teach these kind of methods. And I can give one example that if you have to photograph somebody, my idea of photographing somebody is that the person who is in front of you doesn't know how to be on front of the camera. So yeah, you actually have to direct. Because we have been taught to look good, and if you want to have sort of an image of somebody who has something, I don't know if I should talk about somebody's soul, but something that is authentic, so you need to direct and you need to spend time with people. So actually, what is a little bit funny, because I can say to them that, okay, stand there, look there, but think about your finger, and put it down, and then people actually get really confused. And those kind of moments, I call them off moments. They sort of, I can see their personality in the picture, because otherwise they would be sort of, for me, on front of the camera, but I don't want them to be, to, you know, presenting themselves to me, but being themselves, which is really difficult to get. So it's a slow process.
Sometimes you can slow with your 35 also.
I
use that to work. Especially this work. I pretend sometimes I'm doing so many things in the camera, but I'm actually looking at and then let them be what they wanted to. Then I do.
I was also about to ask the same thing. Like, can you use, like many people are using like the 35mm work as a medium format, or larger, as in like this, pretend to be at those format, because you can see it in the world, the smoke is work, but the digital format, how do you see that?
Yeah, sure. You can do, as a photographer, you can do all kind of tricks, but it means that you have to have trust among the people that you're working with. Because I've done films, documentary films, so my usual method was that I actually leave the camera on the tripod, and people don't know it's on. I actually, there is a way of putting the red light off. And because then when you are behind the camera, the situation changes always. So I think you are allowed to use this kind of tricks, but you have to have sort of, people have to accept that. So somehow you have to have this communication. I'm totally against, you know, kind of stealing somebody's image, so you always have to be close. I never photograph people without them knowing, but I also want that they are relaxed and themselves. Okay, so this is probably interesting for most people. So how do you find your own voice?
I think you should start with pretend.
I mean, it's an interesting question, but I mean, it's quite difficult to answer, I guess. I mean, if you are talking about voice in terms of the language or the aesthetics, then I'm not quite, to be honest, I'm not a big fan of having one voice in terms of the aesthetics, because in this day and age, I don't know what is the like real voice, because we have seen almost everything. So to me, I mean, how you use that language or aesthetic to tell a story, that to me is important. But that doesn't mean like you have to have always work in the same style or same like aesthetic. You can try different things for different story. If certain aesthetics works better in for the certain story, then I think that is that's the good choice.
Yeah, but for example, in your Raute story, how did you choose? It's black and white, you cropped it a bit, right?
No.
No, it's not cropped at all. Okay, so, but choosing black and white is a very sort of strong statement. So how did you decide to do it black and white?
I found it a strange later than I didn't know that when I started shooting that. Because when I was having portfolio reviews or when I sold my work to someone, they were always, most of the editors, they would say, like, this style is dead, or like, it's hard to sell the black and white images or in the newspaper or magazine. You know? So, I don't know, but when I started, it was, because I like black and white, I still like shooting in black and white. I mean, and I thought like this story or this. The way that I was working, black and white, could do the justice. That's the only thing.
But Kishore, you never see color? You never see color?
I mean, I don't know. Black and white is a color to me.
As a director, you was vice principal of Pathshala. So once you were in his class, so one of our ex fellow, you know, you knew her. She came with a beautiful children photography with black and white. So, and that I mean, it stopped me from that day. The teacher said to her, I mean, yeah, you can. You have every right to make it black and white, but and to take children picture, you don't see any color to them. So that's why I'm asking, just joking.
Yeah, but like, I remember, like Saurav, I don't know if he's here, but when I was having, because my earlier work was also in black and white. But now I'm trying to, I've done some color work as well, for the assignment, and also got some project, like last project I did was in color. And I also tried different things. But I don't know, black and white somehow, and then I asked the same question to Saurav when I was having workshop with him in 2010, back in 2010, and he told me a very interesting thing like, there are many bad works in color and there are many bad works in black and white. So just don't think about it. And whatever suits you better, that's good.
I think Kishore is different on matter to matter also. I mean, when I did a 5 years workshop with Philip Blankenship, the very first day, when I showed my portfolio, and he saw it, and next day we went for shoot. Can you recall? And he told me that. You are not going to shoot any color photos. Only you should go for black and white. I can see you see the moments. And it's not fair to me. Huh? I don't know how to take even black and white photographs. I mean, how I see the black and white. So every day I used to take color photographs and then I transfer it in black and white and I keep in the class. So this last year when Shobhimana happened and my work also exhibited there. So as previous teacher, I went to Philip and I said, Philip, my work is exhibited there. And he said, no, I'm going to see another photo. Then I asked Bodhi, can you ask someone to make all these things? And few days ago in this, photo Kathmandu, I was working with Wasif. Wasif was also my teacher. So I asked Wasif, like he's my student that way, that Wasif, why don't you go for color? Then he said, why? And I said, why not? You also, you never influence your style with us. So I think you can explore more. Then he said, I'm shipwrecked lost. You didn't see my new one? Then I said, yeah, I welcomed you. But I think if you're going for color, you may do for best. So
I think the interesting thing now when you tell the story is actually your work is a little bit under-saturated. Yeah. So maybe it's like, maybe towards a little bit towards black and white.
No, there is no chance because I can see the color, maybe sometimes be saturated. I decided, that yeah, I may go for black and white if I feel sometime, if I need to reduce something, if I think that this content, theme is, goes for black and white, I may go. I'm not strict about these kind of things.
If it's the style of a color or black and white, then I usually, I'm very vibrant, so I want everything to be the same way. But I would only transfer images to black and white if I felt like the emotion was more important than aesthetics that I want to share. If I want to answer the how do you find your own voice, I guess my voice is, first of all, I do want to be a mediator between Western and Saudi, especially, or Middle Eastern issues. But also, I want to kind of trigger everyone's thought process. Why are we thinking this way? Why are we stuck in this box of whether it's religious sex or gender issues or social issues? So I feel with all of my stories, I'm always trying to maybe try to find the answers on my own. But I want to have other people share their thoughts with me. So there.
And I spent more than 3 years thinking about these things. Because we know when we are beginner, if we started a particular signature, we may do better than now. And sometimes some mentor forced me also, you should find your language. So I was thinking, I don't feel like, to go a particular way. And for my case, it's always based on content. I did work with my daughter, and it's very poetic, this work is different. So it's always, it's not necessary to all the time, we have to teach to next generation or who coming next, and have to always find a particular signature. Because there are some controversial discussion also. For me, this is, if I am always searching the same language, same style, and the same things, I think it's make me limited for myself.
Yeah, I agree with you, and I think that we speak different languages, so we can also change the language where we tell different stories. And you can also have different voices. But I think when you work on long-term projects, you need to have a voice, because otherwise, I think it becomes very confusing, and you spend a lot of time just thinking about what is the right way of telling the story.
Yeah, I'm starting in my upcoming project. I did my plan, I did my research part, and now I am thinking, as it is, very based on historical aspect. What would be my visual language? I'm thinking, yeah, as an artist, do we have to think something?
Also, I want to add, with a lot of my topics, even as a viewer, not just as a photographer, I feel that as someone who's from the Middle East or a Saudi, we always have this negative connotations towards any image of Saudi. So in my images, I always want to portray as dignified, and I feel with many photographers who come as outsiders, whether it's Saudi or any other country, that as a foreigner, I'm not a local to, I have my own misinterpretations and misconnotations about them, and there's this condescending look. And I must have it, I'm sure I photographed people in Nepal, and I'm like, wow, I'm fascinated, because I'm an outsider. I don't know how they would want to be photographed. So I try, because I don't speak the language with everyone on the street that I photograph, so I try to ask stories and put it in my captions. Whereas if it was my culture, then I understand the captions, and I don't need to rely on that, but I do need each of those people who are photographed in my story to kind of allow me
to share their stories, because if they're not allowing me, whether it's just, you know, not just nodding the head, but they know what the reason for that story is, it will look very condescending, and it will look this pity and this sorrow that I find a lot of photographers, as outsiders to any nation or culture or race, I see that with every image, and it angers me a lot. So I wanted, with my project, to kind of have that voice of, we are Saudi women, we're independent, we have many obstacles, we have a lot of changes to you know, ask for and demand right now, but we still don't need anyone's help. We will fix it on our own.
Yeah, I think the important question, how do you position yourself? Are you, where are you standing? Are you outsider, are you insider, or somewhere between? That's always a challenge. So let's talk about research. You told that you've already done, and tell about the process of research.
Yeah, I mean, as it is a long term, I have freedom to, I'm not bound to any time frame. So I usually work divided in three parts. One is planning. I spend lots of time for planning. Then I usually do research, that is ongoing things for me. If I started shooting. So for me, I think it's very important, because I don't believe 12 to 20 photographs things, I mean, that format. I don't want to take photographs of every day, I mean, killing and blood photography. I wanted to go more, why, I mean, we are, why this, but why every day we are killing by in this world? So I wanted to go something more deeper in my, based on my context. I wanted to do something very intense and make the other world's world ever, and through so many questions. So, for example, I know. In the middle of my research in Birangana project, we have a war in 1971. So those who were victim by Pakistan army, and they are now aged. So I used to go for all the reading materials, newspaper materials, and those who were witnessed that time, I used to interviewed them. I used to go in the field to talk to them. So I think for, because you are telling something which is based on history, and you are going to document them. So if you are something document, you have to be, I mean, more deeper.
And how do you feel, Kishore?
Yes, because long-term project or any story, documentary storytelling is, it's all about knowing whatever you can know about the topic or the people or the subject. So like when I started this project as well, I went through a lot of books and documents that was already done by the anthropologists. By no any chance, I never studied anthropology or sociology or anything. But these kind of documents, in a way, help me to understand them better. Like, I want to quickly show this one document. It was a famous Nepali anthropologist who mysteriously disappeared in the 80s, I guess, 80s, 90s. These are the last paragraph of his research that he did about it. This actually really hit me hard. Like, and I find it really progressive. Like, whatever he said, this was written in 1968, 69, but these things are happening now. You know, like, so, and I also read like a lot of other documents that was done on this community. So I think, yeah, the research is very important to understand the different sides, the different dynamics of the topic.
Yeah, I appreciate Kishore. I mean, we are only serving by our photographers. I think in that research part, we should go, we should involve others, professional also. It can help us.
Nepali anthropologist who, he's a, not anthropologist, he's a human genetics scientist, he told me. He was doing, I read this article after I did the project, it also really intrigued me. This was his article that he wrote, which is like, routers along with other communities, they could be the first one to colonize the Himalayas 7,000 years ago. And like in Nepal, we have, because Nepal is a very diverse society or country, we have more than 100 caste and ethnic groups, and there are about 93 living languages. It's very complicated society. There's this debate going on who came first nowadays. So they could, they might have come first, but I mean, I don't know. So he was actually recently in Nepal to do his research, and then that's him with his partner. So he was here to collect the DNA sample, and now this is in the research. He's doing his part. So I'm also interested in, I mean, this is not nothing to do with directly with my project, but I'm also curious to know about all these things, because that gives me the backdrop to work on.
Yeah, Dustin, you already talked that you have a background, you've studied, so.
I mean, with this issue, it was about marriage, divorce, love. I didn't want to bring facts and numbers. I wanted it to be emotional, intimate access to Sally's stories. So it is based on real stories, but I felt like if I brought numbers and historical facts and everything, then it would kind of make it less personal. So if you just look at the images, then it's, you know, it could be any woman from anywhere in the Middle East, if not even abroad. Only when you read those captions of their own stories and how they felt, then you realize it's very specific to Saudi. My research of finding these women is basically just wait, be patient, and then beg and ask and plead and share your vulnerabilities, and then they'll come forward.
Okay, let's move from patience to anxiety. So, making long-term projects can actually be a very interesting process, because there are always times that you want to give up, because it's, well, you can all read. So how do you feel about this? Actually, how long have you been working in this project?
It has been 4 years, more than 4 years.
And does it help?
About a year of finding all the other women. I photographed my family for the past 2 years, and the wedding images has been, you know, I've been shooting weddings for the past 4 or 5 years.
I started in David, but I went there in 14, and I haven't been there since then. If you see from the beginning, then I started in 12.
But how do you feel about this project going nowhere?
I mean,
worthless.
It definitely happens. I mean, like I said earlier, when you show your work to different people have different opinions, and then somehow affects you. But I mean, also like there comes with these kind of moments when you feel like this is going nowhere. I mean, why I'm doing this? But then sometimes I take a break. I just don't look at the picture for some time, and then I come back. And if I find some reason to go back again, then I continue. Sometimes I show the work to the people who can give the constructive comment, not just like good or bad, but something constructive.
And how do you?
Yeah, I mean, particularly in that project, first 1.5 years, I was studying laws and I experiment laws. So I never give up till I'm thinking if I need to do more. Because it's not someone assigned. So this is the chance those who are working for their own. I think if they can, there's no time out. So
I agree.
actually, we have something to talk about. Let's because there are time for questions. So would you like to start asking questions or we just continue?
Thank you for this. Is there ever an end?
What's that?
Is there ever an end to any of this?
we all do the same thing. We all scream that it's been long term.
Talking from personal experience and being deeply rooted with personal interpretations of where you come from. So, is there ever an end? I struggle with it, so I'm asking.
Sometimes I've noticed that I'm talking about myself and also other photographers, that there is a moment that you have this intuitive feeling that, okay, now it's done. And that's a very sort of a specific moment because you feel it under your skin. You know, I've said what I had to say and I've told the story, so then you can sort of let it go. But it's also a difficult point.
Yeah, I mean, same. I'm like with you, it's not elastic. You cannot make it an end. You know why I'm laughing, Jishan? One student asked too, I mean, someone visited in Pasha. So he asked him, can you tell us what should we do if you stop our long-term project? Then he said, I mean, it's like you're filling toilet. Huh? You know when you stop these things.
It must be a very tired moment because you just feel tired all the time, so. Yeah.
I think there has to be an opinion, otherwise it becomes too tiring. Like, again, I'm saying from personal experience, like, when you start a project, then if you don't try to like bring it to a logical conclusion or something, then it like it feels like something is stuck in your throat, you know, like, and then you can't start another project, you just start overthinking and then sometimes might kill your own project. So I think there should be time when you should like, okay, I'm done with it.
Yeah, I think sometimes it's just a matter of decision because I've seen people that they just go on and on and on and they're never happy and satisfied. And then you just have to decide, okay, 1 month more and then I'm done. So it.
This name. I photographed, first of all, like I started the project for a grant, so it was a 6 month grant and I wanted to photograph as many as I could. It was 9 women. I've done 12 now. So I think it's sufficient for an exhibition or for a story, a publication, but it's not, I want to print it as a book now. I'm filled with this energy, like I want to do this for us as Saudi women. So I want, for a book, that means I need to add more stories, at least 10, maybe 20 more, to have it like maybe 30. And I want to wait to have that gut reaction where I feel like, okay, I'm satisfied of portraying several different, you know, level or middle class, high class, lower class in Saudi, different cities, different religious sects. So when I feel that I've portrayed most of the ones that I can find, then I can say I'm done.
I just want to add something, like, this mentor of mine, and I really inspired by one of his projects that he started, and then just when he started, just in a few years, he made a book out of it, but then he again continued, and then after 30 years, he came out with another book. I mean, people work in a different, like,
hello. I'm Feroz Merchant. Thank you, Kishore. Thank you, Tasneem. Thank you, Mahapa. Thank you for sharing your personal stories. Sorry, not personal. So, just wanted to, as a viewer of photography, as a normal person, what is that one takeaway you all three want the viewer to take, I mean, from these stories, especially, and your previous work? I mean, let's talk about these work, you know. What is that one takeaway or one feeling would you want your viewers to take away, the message? The communication, what is it that you people want people to actually have that take away when they see this work outside in galleries or editorials or a book?
I didn't think even maybe a book, because it's exhibited lots of galleries. All I need to now is, I mean, beyond the gallery, maybe street, maybe some districts and outside of, I mean, where people gather lots. I mean, this time it's exhibited in a mall, so many people come. This is one way, another way, and I mean, for this kind of long-term project, I think, I mean, if I think in future, I may go for book. Sorry?
Feeling of a takeaway. I mean,
what is the key
communication as a visual, what is that one communication you want to give out? Like, the idea is about close distance, the urban class, middle class families having with their housemates, right? So that feeling which a normal person see it on streets or in mall, you said, what is that feeling for you?
As a photographer, why do you feel?
The viewer.
Viewer, what I want.
Yeah.
I told you so already, because I only want to, I mean, think them again, I mean, to see their own mirror, themselves. I mean, it's happening since era to era. So I wanted to make them questions. I mean, do they work for them really? Do they, I mean, make any wasteful voice for them or any holiday for them? I mean, to see discrimination, we don't need to, I mean, go for outside of our gate. I mean, it is here. So in this, I mean, 21st century is going now, and we deal in such an inhuman way. So I just wanted to them to think themselves.
Basim?
Sad women are usually portrayed either as fully black covered, you know, extremist Wahhabis, and they have no rights or privileges or freedom whatsoever, or Shapoholic freeze. A lot of us are in between. So that was, I wanted to kind of shift that mindset, and I wanted the story to be for everyone else, but at the same time, dignified, and we felt like we were allowing people inside. So I knew that I had this power. I had intimate access to Saudi women's lives that no one's ever had before, which is great. But at the same time, I don't want to go back home and be killed for any reason because I did something wrong. And I have to also balance it out that I'm not attacking government, I'm not attacking religion, and I really can't attack society. So it was very difficult for me to kind of maneuver my way around. Those women have already given me that approval. They already feel that this project is what they want to be shared out with everyone here. Mostly it's to change that mindset of the two stereotypes, but also to really find a common ground. Like I said, without the captions, this is universal. The issues that these women have about their marriage and love and divorce, or, you know, stigmas that we have, are really universal. Even for Western independent women, they have the same issues. Single parenting is, you know, among everyone. So we are all the same in the end. And then those words of the captions of the difficulties that we have are more hoping that I will change something back home.
I'm not sure, I mean, what, but like, I think when people see my work, they might know about this community or like that. Some kind of empathy towards these people, like, you know, in Nepal we have this, this thing. So I would quickly like to show this couple of pictures that I, maybe just, that might answer your question. So when I was there for the first time, I took a picture of this guy. Here you can see him taking my picture, and then you can see that. So, and then that's him. And when I went there next time, he was not there. He got killed by, in a bus accident. And then, or he was hit by a bus and he was not there. And suddenly when I was there, everybody used to come to me because they knew I had got this picture, you know. So they would come to me and I would show them the picture in my laptop, and later I printed his picture and I give it back to them. So I think as a photographer, that's what I can do. Or people, what I can give to the people or to this community. If I might answer your question.
No, there's no answers to such question because I, it could all depend to viewer to viewer who's watching it, right? In terms of feeling the expression. But just a gentle this.
Dear Firoz, I think it's over.
No,
you have chance to talk to me. I think there are so many.
Yeah, absolutely. But what's one thing? If given the opportunity, Mahabha, would you do something what Tasneem has done, or what Tasneem would you do what Mahabha has done? Yeah. How would you feel?
I've already started working on a project that is about non-Saudis in Saudi domestic health and also the expats. So I look up to her work and see it.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. The entire thought process that I think a lot of us are curious about, a lot of that came through during this discussion. So I had a very simple question. Wanted to understand that when you started working on your respective projects, so on day one you must have had an initial idea, an initial objective. What is it that you want to achieve at the end of it, or you might have even had a edit in your mind, maybe, as to how it should look. 10 years, maybe 5, 6, 7 years, a lot of things change. People change, priorities change, your objectives change. So my question is it a spontaneous decision that you don't let yourself get swayed by whatever, by time that is changing, and you stick to your original idea? Or is it an evolving body of work that sometimes may be drastically different from what you had initially envisioned?
Yeah, in my case, I mean, it hasn't changed much from the beginning. But I go with open mind when I go to shoot. I don't have any preconceived idea like this is the way I shoot or this is the way I edit. But editing, that obviously, I mean, there are the questions there, we didn't come there, but like editing process is also a very important part of the storytelling. But I usually don't go with the preconceived idea. But like when you start working on something, like I started this work in 2011, and from then I've got exposure to many other visual style or visual aesthetics. I might apply that thing as well, but till now I'm sticking to my initial style.
When I started my project, I wanted to just answer the question of Saudi Arabia is a country that is so attached to the label of Islam. Although reality is we are very far away from it, because if we are the only Muslim good country, that means we've just eradicated the other Muslim countries neighboring us. We are attached to, like I said, three other, you know, controlling angles. So that was it, and then I wanted to explore as a wedding photographer, what's the reality of after. So I didn't understand where I was going to go until you photograph, and one thing leads you to another. And now I feel like at the end, I kind of realized that I have some portraits, but it can't be just one line of thought. So it just somehow started making sense after it was done.
You want anything else? Yeah, I can give you another example. Sometimes it depends on geographical area. In 2010, I had a dream. I worked with Maoist, because I wanted to touch through my camera a freedom fighter. So it's not about photography, rather than I should go to camp. So I spent there, and I even went to district to find those who are victims and those who are, staying in the camp. So, but when I go back, I cannot continue that. Things, one thing, I may continue because I frequently come here, but the situation is totally different. So it's related to, context also, political decision also, because they cover everything.
I think we have time for two more questions.
Thank you for sharing with me and with all of us about the story, void, medium and long-term project. I got a question because when we work on the long-term project, we need financial support to support the project. Can you share with us about this financial to complete the project?
It's depend on, again, content. I can share my this story. It's not that much buzzy things, and as it's not assigned work, it's my own. I mean, funded work. So I don't care anyone. This is the positive things. Those who are own funded for his or her work. And the work now I'm going to do is a bit budget related, more than budget related. I mean, it's huge. And now I'm thinking it's a dilemma. I should go for someone. Maybe their point of view is different. Those who are going to fund, they have some particular desire about our. So I'm thinking the things I most hate to do work with. Development sector. For survival. So I mean, run for that things more. I usually say no, I'm not going to do. I may go for that way I collect my money or budget. I don't know others, but I love to work my own way. So I'm the founder of my project. Then I can do is in a freedom way. Open.
I'm lucky enough to be a wedding photographer, so I actually timed all the women that I photographed to be in the same city at the a day or two or a few days after the wedding that I was shooting in that city. So I kind of had that covered somewhat. I would stay with those women, so I'm also not really covering my accommodation. It was just travel. I applied for the Magnum Foundation / Prince Klaus / AFA, Arab Fund for Culture and Arts. It was one grant, but there were three of them together. So that actually helped, not just for financial, it was more of a timeline. I was forced to work as much as possible. And I'm like, what's the word when you leave everything to the last minute? That's me. So that's what it helped me with the most.
Difficult, like Mawa says, I also do a lot of other assignment to leave to survive, basically. That's one reason it's taken so much time to complete this story, because I spend most of my time here in Kathmandu doing other stops, and then because when I go there I need to separate my whole time, a month or 2 months, to go and sleep there. And time is money nowadays, so it's difficult, and I haven't got any funds so far to continue my project. In the beginning we had got a small grant for the travel during the workshop, but after that I've been doing my own personal, so I work in other projects, the commercial project, and I invest that thing in my personal stories.
And these two are lucky enough, because they're, not above 30. Huh? I started photography after 30.
Above 30.
And I never send my work for any grant anywhere.
I just did it once.
So I have to say, self is the best of that.
One last.
I'm curious to know that the nature of photography is quite isolated. The photographers go out, they chase their stories, and they become quite embedded in them. And especially in long-term projects, when you're investing so much time, I'm sure all three of you know of Darcy Padilla's Julie project, where she chased her story for 17 years, and she became an intricate part of the story, where the husband, most of us know about the story, but the husband located the Julie again through the photographs. So, and taking from what Mawa said, that everything that is personal is political, and everything that is political is personal, I believe in that as well. One is the impact that you have on the viewer, but what kind of impact does chasing this kind of project have on you personally? Because it's a hard chunk of time in your life. And if you're that attached to something, I'm sure it does have an impact on you as well. So a little bit about that.
Of course, I'm part of society. I'm part of politics.
Right. No, but if you're, I was talking to Azadeh the other day, and she said that she did research for a project for 5 years, and at the end of it, she ended up quite depressed, because you're researching death, and you're essentially going on asking people about this scene of crime, and that's the nature of that project. I'm interested in knowing if the project has changed, I'm sure it has, changed you personally, so could we have a bit of a look at that?
Yeah, of course, it's depend on, circumstances depend on, I mean, what you don't know, what is coming, I mean, what is the complicacy or what's the question come you are going to face. It's all depend on that things. Maybe I'm going to face that thing, then I can give you an answer.
My project gave me a lot of closure, especially when I read the diary that I haven't read for more than, you know, 12, 13 years, because I have so much anger and bitterness towards my parents and my family. You allowed me to get married at a young age. Why didn't you stop me? Why didn't you support me when I wanted a divorce, etc., etc.? And then reading that diary, it kind of showed up a lot of things that I just didn't think or remember at all, which was my parents weren't, you know, supportive. They didn't want me to get married initially. Also, a lot of women who were not photographed, but they were viewed like my aunts, for instance. So very close relatives, when they saw it, they're like, you're always showing divorce and unhappy and widow and it's death and sadness. Like, why can't you show perfect marriages? Like, we're happily ever after, you know? And my father also got upset. He's like, you know, I'm a good husband. And there's no story of a good husband. I'm like, no, your father. He's like, he has dementia now. So why can't you just show a perfect family? And maybe that's my own way of venting. Maybe I feel like I want to kind of push everyone and just ask, and yeah, it's a lot of anger maybe issues that I have. But I also felt like if you share only the glossy images of beautiful, happy marriages, then nothing is going to change. And I feel like we need to bring the extreme sometimes to kind of feel like, oh, we're provoking thoughts and change.
In my case, I mean, one reason of doing this long, particularly this project is it gives me chance to go out and see Nepal. Kathmandu is very centralized. Kathmandu is Nepal basically. And when I go out, I get to see the chance to see Nepal, real Nepal. And this one particular story has given me so many. And to say as a selfish photographer, it has also given me exposure to this particular project. So whatever I am today as a photographer is because of this project. So this is maybe one thing I've got out of it. And what I want to give back is like, maybe this picture might work someday as some kind of documentation of this community or this tribe.
And you know, today I don't want you to say, such a mind-blowing images you produce. I want from you that you should ask that the story you are telling is not connected. Will you be able to connect with the audience and with me? So, how long it will take times, no matter.
When I published this work, I had a lot of good, positive feedback, and it was all great, obviously, but for me to receive emails from Saudi men or text messages from Saudi men saying, thank you for sharing a point of view that we never considered before. Thank you for sharing those stories of women that we didn't know we had so much power over. Just to exist as a man is something powerful. Like, you know, especially in our society where everything is segregated and there's a hierarchy of male domination of some sort. So for them to say that, just a few words, meant the world to me, and it meant that, oh, I have hope. So it has given me a lot of good,
Thank you all so, so much. Thank you, Anna Barik, Jordai, Tasneem, Mawa. That was, I think, one of, for me, because I'm also involved in long-term projects, I think it was very, very innovative, and thank you for being here.